I want to share with you about God's design for work, God's mind for work. And probably to introduce the topic, I would like to begin by telling you a story, because I know Ugandans in particular love stories. Now I must warn you at the beginning that I don't know if this story is true or not. So please don't believe it. Whatever you hear, just know it could be true, it might not be, but what matters most is the point we are likely to learn from it. Now this story is about a certain man who is a representative of the World Bank. I am told that one time this man came to Uganda, and his major concern was why Uganda is not paying its debts. As you know, Uganda is a very huge debtor to so many people, including the World Bank. So this man always wondered, why is it that Uganda, of all countries, never pays its debts? What's going on? So he gets on the plane, he comes to Uganda to find out. Now on his first day, as he was trying to get used to the environment, he's walking by the lakeside, and he meets a fisherman who is resting under a tree and whistling some African tune. So he comes to this man, he looks at his watch, it's about 10 in the morning, and he's confused. What is this man doing under the tree at 10 in the morning? Isn't he supposed to be working? So he comes to this fisherman and asks him, man, what are you doing under the tree? It's just 10 a.m. in the morning. Why are you not at work? And the man is like, I have already worked for the day. I'm a fisherman, I was at the lake this morning, and I caught two fish. One fish is for my family to eat, another fish is for me to sell and buy some basic necessities for my home. Now this white man was confusing. You mean all you could get from the lake was two fish? Why don't you go back, try to fish more, then maybe eat them or sell as many as you can, get more money and give a better life to your family? And the fisherman was like, white man, I don't understand what you're talking about. My family already has one fish for food. I told you I'm going to sell another one for money. What else do you want with me? After I have caught many fish, so what? What next? And this white man is like, you can get a lot of fish and you can sell it, and after selling it, maybe you can buy a bigger boat, and with that bigger boat, you can make big business, and after getting big business, eventually you become a rich man. And this African man looks at him and says, and after becoming a rich man, what next? And the white man said, look, when you become a rich man, you are able to take your children to better schools, good medical care, you build a retirement home, and after that, you just sit down, relax, and enjoy the riches you have. And the African man looks at the white man and says, what do you think I'm doing right now? I am already resting. Why do I have to get big fish, big boat, big house, more money, so that at the end of it all, I can come back and rest? I am already resting. So the white man looks at this guy, he nods his head, and as the story goes, he goes back to World Bank headquarters and he says, forget, Ugandans will never pay their debt. Now you might be wondering how a story like this ties in our topic tonight. You see, this story is about work and the different attitudes and perspectives we have about work. For the white man, work means wake up very early in the morning, walk around the clock, do this, do that, sweat a lot. By the end of the evening, the big paycheck you have is what shows that you have worked. Now for the African, work means get the basic necessities, and if you can even get them at 8 in the morning, why not? Just walk around the village, whistling, collecting rugambo. After all, you have finished your work. You will agree with me that work is one of the most controversial topics that anybody can ever talk about. And when it comes to the Christian circles, I think this is something that has been debated and fought against on different fronts since time immemorial, and many people have arrived at so many different conclusions that you even wonder what work really is at the end of the day. If I can give you a few views that so many people out of the so many debates have come to, one of them is that work is not something that should interest anyone. After all, according to the Bible, work is a curse. And since work is a curse, it means that people who love to work are actually cursed. And if you don't want to be one of the cursed people, it's better you relax, go whistling around, enjoy your life, because after all, work means that you are cursed. And those who are Christians and probably people I would call hyper-spiritual have even gone ahead and said, work is a curse that God has delivered us from since Jesus died for us. So for you as a Christian to continue working is actually an insult for what God has done for you. And they are quick to quote passages like Matthew chapter 11, 28, which says, come to me, you who are weary and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So they are saying, look, if Jesus is saying we need to come to him and he gives us rest, how come you are calling us to go and work and get tired and sweat? So between you and Jesus, whom should we believe? And we all know the answer. We all believe Jesus, right? So it's time for us to go and relax in the presence of the Lord. And as a matter of fact, we have so many Christians today who do not want to work simply because Jesus is calling those who are tired to come and rest. And they're saying, I've been tired for a long time. Now that Jesus has become Savior and Lord, it's time to relax.
Amen.
And of course, for those of you who love the Old Testament, we have this popular Psalm, Psalm 127, which says that unless the Lord build the house, the builders build in vain. Unless the Lord watches the city, the watchmen watch in vain. And yet those whom the Lord loves, he blesses them even while they are sleeping. So somebody quotes that verse and says, you see, you don't have to work for blessings to come to you. In fact, if you want God's blessings, you just need to sleep a little more. And we have a generation of believers, especially young people, who are really sleeping as much as you can imagine, and they are hoping when they wake up, there will be sacks of money under their bed. When they wake up, God will have done their exams, and they will be having A's in their papers, and they have the scripture to back them up. And how dare you challenge God's word? After all, God is blessing those who are what? Who are sleeping. So how do you get God's blessings?
Sleep
and snore. And when you wake up, you will be singing, it is well with my soul. But one of the other views that we have here is that we have people who have put a distinction in work. And they have said, there is something that we call secular work, and that is work that non-believers do. And there is something we call sacred work, or if you want, anointed work, and that is the work for believers. They don't want to be doctors, they don't want to be lawyers, they don't want to be grass cutters, they don't mention it all. They don't want to be border riders. Reason they give, because they are saved. And once you are saved, you cannot afford to be doing things that worldly people do. You need to be doing anointed things, you know, speak in tongues, pray for the sick, you know, talk about some Greek terminology. And that's when you feel, yeah, I am in the place where God has called me to be. So we have also those people. But we also have people who are saying, the Bible is telling us Jesus is coming back soon. So why would we want to be wasting time working, going to school, acquire degrees, become a doctor, and just when you have started doing your first surgery in the hospital, Jesus comes back. So what we need to do is to be preparing for Jesus to come back.
Amen.
So from now on, everybody lay down your tools. If you have a degree, put it in the case or burn it. From now on, all roads lead to the prayer mountain, where we will be praying for heaven to come down. And when Jesus comes to pick us, oh, what a wonderful joy it will be. So you have a generation of Christians whose job is to go on the prayer mountain and cry and pray and babble from morning to evening. And when they come back from the prayer mountain, they are wondering what has happened with the world around us. They have a Muslim president and they're saying this Muslim is also. They have the best man in the business is a Hindu. The headmaster of the school nearby is a witch doctor. And they say the devil is a liar. But why is the witch doctor the headmaster? Because Christians are where? They are at the mountain waiting for Jesus to come back. So what you have is a Christian community that has turned into a monastery. They are busy in full-time prayer, and that is their work. They are praying Jesus down. But meanwhile, the economy is being run by Muslims. The witch doctors are now our headmasters. Our doctors and nurses are homosexuals, and they are busy singing, "This world is not my home. I am just passing." Now, in the midst of these views and perspectives that people have about work, you are probably left wondering, so what are we really supposed to do? But you see, you cannot answer that question until you raise many more foundational questions that I hope I would like to ask you tonight. I am not planning to provide the answers, but I hope I can provoke you to think if you haven't been thinking, especially in this area of work. So question number one would be, when we talk about work, what are we really even talking about? What is work anyway? When did work begin, for instance? Is work a curse, as so many people say? Or could it be something that humans were uniquely designed to do? When we think about work, and we read the passages that, for instance, talk about Jesus becoming poor so that we might become rich, do we really still need to work if Jesus has already made us rich? Should Christians even work anyway? And if they work, where should they work? In the church? Only in the temple? Only in Christian NGOs? How far can they go? Can a Christian work in a restaurant? Can a Christian be a taxi driver? Can a Christian be a gatekeeper? Or like the Nigerians would be saying, me over my dead body. What is the purpose of work? If really this is something we need to do, it must have a purpose. But what is the purpose of work? And me being a Christian, how does my Christian faith relate with the work that I do, or at least I'm supposed to do? If I am a Christian, and I find myself in a career, for instance, where I'm a nurse, or I'm an engineer, or I'm a plumber, how does my faith or my Christian belief system relate with the kind of work that I do? Of course, these are just sample questions. There are a number of questions you could ask yourself about this topic. But then again, you realize that these questions cannot be answered from anywhere else apart from going to the scriptures. Because it is in the scriptures that we begin to find out about what work is, when it began, why it began, who was supposed to do it, how he's supposed to do it, what happens when he doesn't do it, and of course what happens when he eventually does it. So to make this approach very simple for us tonight, I have separated this into about four different phases. Number one, I would like to introduce us to what I call a biblical framework of work. What does the Bible itself say about work? What did they say about work that can be very helpful for you and me? So we have work before the fall, work after the fall, work in redemption, and work during the apostolic times. I hope that makes a simple outline for you. So let's go back to the beginning and look at work before the fall. And there is no better place to find out than to go to the very beginning in the book of Genesis, which actually means origins. And if you have read your book or the book of Genesis before, then you already know how it actually begins. When the curtain opens in the book of Genesis, immediately we find ourselves face to face with a very busy God. The writer of Genesis tells us that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And from there, he begins to break down the details on how God created the earth. He talks about the different things that we are created on the different days. But from day one to day six, what you see
is a God busy at work.
I don't know if he would have been sweating at that time because of the so much work he was doing. So number two that we find in this opening of the Genesis passages is that God is not just working, but God is enjoying the work that he is doing. In the same passage, we are told that God created, and at the end of every day, he looked back at what he had created and he said it was good. He was not just modeling things and walking away and saying, "Ooh, what a long day." No, 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 no. After the creation on every day, he looks back, he sees what he has created, the beauty, the art in it, the design, the quantity, the quality, and he says, "Wow, what a wonderful work for the day." So we see a God who is not just working, but a God who enjoys to work and delights in the work of his hands. But he is not just an enjoyable God. Number three, he is also a God of quality. He is not just working, but he minds how he works. And that's why he can, at the end of the day, look back and say, everything was good. There is no fair, there is no somehow, there is no, well, we were almost there today, or maybe next time we will perfect it. No, 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 no. Everything he did, the standard was good. Day one, good. Day two, good. Day three. In fact, when we come to day six, he even takes it much further and says everything was very good. So you cannot think about work without thinking about God. You cannot think about work without thinking about enjoyment and delight in doing that work. You cannot think about work without thinking about quality. That God is not just interested in creating so many things, but he is also interested in the quality of what he is creating. Now you might be there and you are thinking, well, we can see what God does. That's what we expect of him. After all, he is God. Isn't God supposed to do good things? We would be surprised if some of God's things were not good enough, right? And so you're saying, yeah, we understand that God had to do all those things. After all, he is God. But what has that got to do with me? Remember, guys, he is God and I'm not. So would you blame me if I didn't do what God did? Well, we would understand you if the story of Genesis stopped only at God. But you see, it goes much further. When we come to the sixth day, one of the things that God has created is man himself. And you read the story of how God creates man, and one of the first things you read about is that he says, "Let us create man in our own image." He defines man in terms of his nature, on how man will be, but he also defines man in terms of purpose, on what man will do. And as you read the Genesis account, there are so many things, but I just want to pick out two. Number one is that man, in terms of his nature, is created after the image of God, in the likeness of God, meaning that he is created with the ability to like what God likes, to love what God loves, to imitate what God does. He's created in the likeness of God himself. But also number two, that man is created for a purpose. When you read in Genesis chapter 2, in fact, the writer reminds us why man was created. Genesis chapter 2, from verse 1 to 25, there are so many verses, but I'll just read a shorter passage. And this is what it says. That these are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made earth and the heavens, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. Do you hear what the author of Genesis is saying? He describes how things were made and the things that were lacking there, and then he concludes saying, for there was no man yet to work the ground. And in that very passage, we are told what God expects man's purpose to be, that man is being created to work the ground. Man is being created to take care of what God has created. The God who delights delights in what he has done. The God who minds about quality extends the same responsibility, the same expectations, and the same standards of work to the man that he has created as the epitome of creation. He creates him and designs him with specific, unique abilities that are different from the rest of creation, and those abilities are so designed in man that he will become a caretaker of what God has designed. So it's not enough to say that God is a working God, but it has implications that the same working God has extended the same responsibility to man to continue working in taking care of God's creation, in preserving, in sustaining what God has made. In other words, man created in the image of God is also expected to work like God does. And when man works, he mirrors the creative ability of God. And of course, man has been given the privilege to partner with God in sustaining what God has created. Now, you will remember that we are talking about God, an all-sufficient, an all-powerful, sovereign God. Suddenly, he didn't need help from anybody. Having created all these things in 6 days, he could have done without man and he would have still sustained his creation. So the fact that this God, in his sovereignty and power, he chooses to invite man into a partnership in which man can take care of what God has made itself is an act of God's undeserved grace. And when you understand that as a Christian, you begin to realize that working is a privilege. You begin to realize that working is an act of God's grace. And if God has considered you that valuable and that important that you should partner with him in his wonderful, glorious creation, how much more should you go about it rejoicing? How much more should you go about it with great eagerness? How much more should you be grateful and thankful after a day's work when you look back and see what you have done and it is wonderful? How much more should you be saying, oh God, thank you that you have considered me worthy to partner with you in this work? Knowing that he could have called the angels to work with him, knowing that he would have called the animals actually to do that work, but he chose you instead of everything else. Understanding that framework itself gives you reason to love what you do, to rejoice in the work that God has given you, to be grateful that God has even invited you to work. It leads into a life of thankfulness, reverence, and worship. But you also notice that this kind of partnership that God has called us into is a responsibility. God is expecting us to do certain things, and to do them the way he expects us to do them, and he is expecting us to do them in the very way that he would have done them. What am I trying to say? That God has not only given us the opportunity to work with him, but he has also assigned us where we work, how we work, and why we do what we do. In other words, what I'm trying to say, that all of work understood in this biblical framework is actually God's work. If God has blessed you in school to be a school teacher, you are still working on behalf of God. So there is this thinking of distinction, or where people think that God's work is only when I'm a pastor, or I'm an usher at church, or I'm a worship leader, and therefore anybody who is not serving in the church is on the lower level, is in the economy class. For us who serve God, we are in the first class. And there is a tendency to find Christian leaders developing pride and arrogance simply because they think they are pastors. They are more important than the people who cut the grass around the church. They are more important than the woman who serves lunch to the pastoral team at church. And they despise the people who are not called pastors or apostles or evangelists. And tonight I am here to challenge you and tell you that is a wrong view of work. All work is God's work, and wherever God has pressed you to do whatever thing he has put in your hands, You must still do it as unto the Lord. You must put in diligence and carefulness. You must do it with gratefulness and joy, knowing that it is God who has called you to work. It is God who has designed you and given you the abilities, the skills, and the talents to do what you do. And when you understand that, then you begin to realize that I can serve God as a chapati maker, I can serve God as a boda boda rider, I can serve God as a shamba boy, I can serve God as a house girl, as well as one could serve God as a pastor. We are not just created to work, but we are created to do good work. It's not just working, but it is also how you go about it. The Apostle Paul tells us, as he writes to the church at Ephesus, and in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, he says, that for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Paul, writing to the Ephesians, reminds them, number one, that God has called them to work. That God prepared work for each one of us, even before we came to be. And that this God has called us to do good work. Not just any work. Not just to work for the sake of getting a salary. Not just to work because the majority are working, therefore I have no option. Not just to work because you are avoiding to be idle. But work because God has created you specifically, purposefully, to do good work. And work done well is pleasing to God. Work done with diligence and joyfulness is pleasing to God. So what are some of those few conclusions we could make from this first phase? Number one is that God is the orchestrator and the designer of work. Number two is that God's work in creation becomes a model for all those created in his image, that we must work, but also work according to the design that God has given us for work. Understood very well, work becomes a divine mandate, a divine responsibility that has been bestowed upon you and I to work. And that when we work, doesn't matter wherever we work for the glory of God, and we must work well and produce quality. Another thing we can learn from this work before creation is that, contrary to the erroneous view we hear that work is a curse, we find that work is actually not a curse. Work is not even the result of a curse. Because you notice, before the curse comes, God is already working, unless you want to say God is also cursed. But God is already working even before the curse comes into the picture. The curse comes into the picture in Genesis chapter 3 verse 15. But from Genesis chapter 1, God has been working, and he has been calling man to work in the same manner that God is working. So there is no way that work could be a curse from God when God designed work even before the curse came to be. But also number four is that we have been called to work with and to work for God. That work is a privilege that we need to embrace with joyfulness and gratefulness, because God has graciously called us to partner with him in such an important job. Now I know some of you are saying, well, we understand when you say that. In fact, the picture you paint of work before creation is so wonderful, is so glorious. But you see, not as what you have forgotten. Things have changed. They are no longer what they used to be. Rogers, you spent a long time reading Genesis chapter 1 and 2. You need to read chapter 3 and realize that you are behind schedule. Something went wrong. I've been reading Genesis chapter 3 for a long time. Rogers, may I show you? There is a problem. And you are quick to take me to Genesis chapter 3. And you read for me from verse 18, say, to 19. And you speak out those words that God speaks to Adam, where he says, that cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field, and by the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, and for you are dust, and to dust you shall return. You see, Rogers, what we've been telling you? Things have changed. Things are serious, my friends. Did you hear what God just said? The ground is cursed because of you. From now on, instead of harvesting maize, you will be harvesting more thorns and thistles than the maize you planted. Did you hear that, Rogers? Now you must sweat, now you must struggle, now you must be tired. And guess what? When you are all tired and finished, you go back to the dust where you came from. Rogers, how can you say work is a beautiful thing? How can you really say work is a blessing and something we should do with a smile? Is that what you call working with a smile when you are cleaning the sweat from your forehead? When you are going to your garden and instead of picking 100 maize, you find you have picked 20 of them and the 8 instead are weeds? Is that what you call joy and blessing? The first thing you notice here is that there is a misunderstanding often of what exactly was cast in Genesis chapter 3. Many times we are quick to look at Genesis chapter 3 and we say, you see, the snake was cursed, Eve was cursed, Adam was cursed, work itself was cursed, everything is cursed, we are finished. You see? But is that really what Genesis chapter 3 is actually saying? Number one, God says, the ground is cursed because of your disobedience, Adam. What is cursed?
The ground.
The ground. Not work that man is expected to do on the ground. So what does this mean? That work is still as good as it was before the fall of man. What has changed is the ground. The ground where he harvested without planting, now he must plant. The ground where he just walked and enjoyed the fruits of the garden, now he will be fighting the weeds and the thorns, and he will do so with a lot of sweat, a lot of exhaustion, and a lot of struggle. Work which was always positive and rewarding will no longer be so. Because you plant is no longer a guarantee that you harvest. Because you have done everything there is not a guarantee that you are going to get the maximum yield. There will be disasters, there will be catastrophes, sometimes it will not even rain, you will not harvest anything. The nature of work has changed in a sense that it will be more difficult, it will be more tiresome, but work in and of itself is not a curse. You also notice that from now on, work is not something man will do with a smile on his face. He will do it with sweat. He will do it with loneliness, he will do it with grumbling and anger, and he will do it for a lifetime. You notice that Genesis 3 is saying, and this will be so till man shall return to the dust. Now, what does this mean? Some bad news and some good news. The bad news is that whether you like it or not, you must work. And whether you like it or not, you don't only work for 2 days or 2 months or 3 years, but you must work for the whole time of your life till you return to the ground. Now, that's not so much good news. But the good news is that in the process of work and sweat and struggle, you will have bread to eat. Many times we fail to see that blessing. We only look at the curse and we walk away grumbling. But do you realize that God could have said, you shall toil, you shall sweat, you will work, and you will harvest nothing? That was also very possible for God to say. But even in the midst of this judgment, we still see God's mercy triumphing. He says, yeah, for sure you will sweat, but guess what? You will have some bread. He says, Eve, for sure you will have pain during childbirth, but at the same time, you will have children. So there is even a blessing sandwiched between the judgment that we see in Genesis chapter 3. But also we note something very interesting here, that while man was created to take care of the garden, at the fall, man has been thrown out of the garden. He will now work the fields outside the garden, but not the garden itself. Now what does that mean for us? That man who was working in the presence of God, enjoying the spacious nature of a garden that was already planted for him, now he must begin from scratch and struggle for himself. But even more importantly, now he must work in the fields outside God's presence. So the picture you have in Genesis chapter 3
is a man full of guilt, a man full of loneliness, a man who is struggling and sweating, a man who is doing work, but work that no longer has God at the center. And work without God at the center becomes meaningless. Instead of work becoming a means to fellowship and fulfillment with God, now work becomes an end in and of itself. Man begins to work for work's sake, not for the sake of glorifying God or finding meaning and fulfillment in God. So the picture of man in chapter 3 is a man who becomes self-centered, a man who becomes inferior, a man who begins to look for joy and peace and fulfillment in the work that he does. And such a man is going to be proud, such a man is going to be arrogant, such a man is likely to think that by doing a more popular work with bigger titles is what will make people respect you, give you the joy and the fulfillment that you have. And the picture you see in the foreign created order today is a picture of a man who's striving for recognition, a man who works not so that God can be pleased, but so that people can know that he's also around. A man who is fighting for big titles and positions and huge offices because he thinks that the bigger you are in the eyes of the public, the more fulfilled you are. And of course, such a man has not read the book of Ecclesiastes, where the richest of all men, after the pursuit of all riches and all gains and all profits you can ever think about, he comes back in the evening, all tired and weary, and he says, all under the sun is vanity in vanity. When you work without God at the center, when you work without God being the motivation for your work, you become miserable, you become self-centered, you are ever striving, you are looking for identity and fulfillment and purpose in the work itself, and work has nothing to offer you. So you end up as a miserable, hopeless, and helpless man. And that is the kind of man we see after Genesis chapter 3. From then on, work is a battleground. It is a war. The superior oppresses the inferior. The director makes sure he squeezes and pays little to those that are working under him. He's trying to make a big name. He's trying to find identity and fulfillment in the work itself apart from God. Man outside the garden, work outside the garden, very miserable, very hopeless, very helpless. All would have been dark and lost, but thank God, you see, the Bible is not only the Old Testament. It also has the new. I don't know whether that excites you. If all we had was only the Old Testament, where we end up with a picture of a sweating, striving, miserable, hopeless, helpless man, I don't know where we would be today. But thank God for the New Testament. Because when the New Testament opens, it opens with a new beginning. It opens with a new creation. It opens with good news, not bad news from Genesis chapter 3. It opens with great news from the angel. One evening, an angel comes into a field where the shepherds were taking care of their flock by night, doing their business as usual. They are shepherds, and of course, as a shepherd, they were very despised men of the day. Nobody thought anything good could come out of them. Even in the darkness of the night, instead of sleeping and resting, they are busy taking care of the sheep. There is no doubt that their work is miserable, unenjoyable. It is one of strife. It is one of loneliness. Out in the field there, they are separated from the rest of the community. All you see on the faces of the shepherds is misery and hopelessness until that one dark night. And the angel comes in, and he has a wonderful message. He says, I have good news for you. Today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born. And he goes ahead and he tells them how they would find the Savior wrapped in swaddling clothes in a manger somewhere in Bethlehem. And of course, the story doesn't stop there. It is followed by a crowd of angels who gather around them. And what are they singing? Glory to God in the highest and peace on earth upon those men on whom the Lord favors. Great news indeed. There is a new beginning here. And the next thing you see
is this shepherd saying, we need to go and see what is really going on? A savior? What is he doing in a manger? Why is he a baby? We expected a savior who is the big man, the one who will save us and deliver us from this chaos and the misery we are living in. But anyway, as miserable shepherds, they have nothing to lose. They said, let's just go there and see what's going on. They go there, they look at the baby Jesus, but when they come back, there is something that has happened along with this shepherd. Dr. Luke in chapter 2 records and he says that they came back full of joy, praising and worshiping about the wonders of God. And they told the whole story to the people who were in Bethlehem. These shepherds have been transformed. Now, please notice, they have not been transformed into pastors and apostles. They have not become doctors and engineers and pilots and all those dream jobs you think about. When they came back from the manger, they were still shepherds. But they were transformed, redeemed shepherds. Once upon a time, miserable, hopeless, helpless shepherds in the dark of the night, they are now running around the whole of Bethlehem and saying, come and see the wonders of God. This is indeed good news. And you know what is interesting? Dr. Luke doesn't tell us what happened after their testimony. Did they continue and become evangelists? We don't know. Did they join full-time pastoral ministry and begin some churches around Bethlehem? We don't know. But most likely, the likely thing that could have happened is that they remained shepherds. They went back to their flocks, but this time they took care of their flocks from a new perspective. They were now joyful, praising, worshiping shepherds. They no longer took care of sheep so that they can eat them when they grow. Now they took care of sheep for the glory of God. They nursed them like Jesus, the good shepherd. Shepherds, yes. Are they still in the field? Yes. Is it still cold out there? Yes. Is it sometimes miserable? Yes. But are they happy and peaceful and joyful? Yes. Praise the name of the Lord. That's what I call good news. And you see, that's what the gospel did. The gospel changes everything. When Jesus came into the picture, work didn't stop, but work took on a different meaning. Jesus does not just redeem you and me as human beings. He's not just after our spirits and our souls, but he redeems us holistically. He redeems our thinking, he redeems our careers, he redeems our relationships, he redeems our souls. Salvation is holistic. And in this New Testament perspective, we see that even work itself becomes redeemed. God's people, who no longer have to find their identity in the work they do, but who now find their identity and purpose and meaning in union with Christ, will now work not so that they can find fulfillment, but because work now is the best way they can express their gratefulness to Jesus who has redeemed them. What you have is a generation of Christians eager to work, running around in their different careers, in their different professions, and they have one mission, not to work for work's sake, but to work as an act of gratefulness that Christ has redeemed them, to work as a sign that the new nature in them that comes from Christ now calls them to mirror the creative abilities of God that God had one time given them in creation. So the gospel changes everything. The gospel changes our motivation for work. We no longer work because we get money. We no longer work because we find fulfillment. Now we work because, as the redeemed people of God, in the renewed image of God, we want to mirror God's character, God's nature, God's artwork. God's joy becomes our joy. God's things that make him happy become the things that make us happy. Our motivation for work has been redeemed. The way we conceive work itself has been redeemed. From a self-salvation, a self-advancement, a self-fulfillment, now we begin to do a self-sacrificing service for the greatness and glory of God and for the good of others. Paul, writing to the Philippians in chapter 2, from 3 and 4, he says, that do nothing from a selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant.
significant than yourself. Let each one of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. The gospel does not only change our motivation and conception of work, but it also provides a high standard of ethics in the way we do our work. Remember that God is not just interested in us working, but he also cares how we do our work. We no longer just show up so that we can say we were at the office today, but now we exercise integrity, we exercise diligence, we aim at excellence as we do our work. Whatever we do it to the glory of God, we do it joyfully, we do it gratefully, we do it reverently. You read Matthew 5:16, and Jesus says that, let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. When the world sees the way you live and the things you do and the way you go about the work that God has given you, you challenge them, you surprise them. They begin to wonder, why does he do things the way he does them? Why is it that he comes to work on time? He minds about the quality of his work. He never cheats his bosses. He's the most trusted employee in the company. Why does he behave the way he does? And the answer they are likely to find is because you are a Christian. Jesus says that when, as a Christian, you do your work in honor of the Lord, your work itself becomes a testimony that indeed Jesus is at work in your life, and non-believers who normally would have despised God actually begin to revere him and to respect him. In 1 Thessalonians 4:9-12, Paul says that, now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. For that indeed is what you are doing to all the brothers throughout Macedonia. But we urge you, brothers, to do more and more, and aspire to live quietly, and to mind your affairs, to work with your hands, number one, as we instructed you, so that you may walk properly before outsiders and be dependent on no one. 2 points here to bring up. Number one is that even the apostles, the early believers of Jesus, expected everyone to be involved in some kind of work. The apostles instructed the churches to work. But more importantly, they instructed them to work properly, to work in a manner that when the non-believers see them, they actually realize that they are redeemed people. They are unique people. They are special people. And the non-believers from that testimony are able to glorify the Lord. I remember when I was in secondary school, we used to sing this hymn, which says that they are watching you, marking the things that you do, hearing the things that you say. Let them see the Savior as he shines in you, and let his power control you what? Every day. Do you know that hymn?
Yes.
The world is watching us. They are not just seeing what we do, but they are also seeing how we do it. And the way we do it, we will tell them whether Jesus' power is at work in our lives or not. So work is not just work for its sake, but work becomes a credible testimony and a witness that Jesus is at work in your life, that Jesus is Lord. And what happens is that you leave non-believers admiring you and wishing them that they were like you. And eventually, they actually come to know Christ and they glorify him. The Apostle Paul in Philippians 2:14-15 says that, do all things without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God, without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights of the world. As believers, we are Christ's light that is shining into a dark world. And we are called to live blameless lives, upright lives, and that must also be reflected in the work that God has called us to do. Are you a nurse? Do you are nursing in a manner that people will see Christ shining in and through you? Are you just a housewife? Do your housewife work in a manner that when people look at you and see what you do and the way you do it, they are able to say, if this is what Jesus does in a man's life, then I want to follow this Jesus. But we also notice that when work is done, especially from God's perspective, it not only becomes a blessing to us and for the glory of God, But it also becomes a benefit for our loved ones. The Apostle Paul talks about the necessity for believers to work and provide for their relatives. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, he says that, but if anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for members of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. It is a responsibility of believers that we not only work for ourselves or for work's sake, but we also work for the benefit and the blessing of one another. All the work that we do, ultimately, we do it unto the glory of God. In fact, when you come even towards the end of the New Testament, you find that even the judgment of believers will depend upon their lifestyle and work while they were living. We are told that the man's work will be brought into scrutiny, and the giving out of rewards or punishment will also be contingent on how a man lived and worked for God while he was in the world. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13 to 15, the Apostle Paul says that their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what has been built survives, the builder will receive a reward. If it is burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though only as one escaping through the flames. So even the giving of rewards on that last day for believers will also be based on how you lived your life in your Christian life. How did you live your life? Was it to the glory of God or not? How did you understand the work that God gave you to do, whether it was what you would call secular or sacred? Did you do it in conformity to God's will? Did you do it out of motivation for service to God and service to fellow man? The nature of your work will also determine whether you get a reward or not. Now, more could be said about work. But as I look at my watch, I might be having about 9 seconds before I finish. So let me just give a quick wrap-up, and then I will be done. As we reflect on the subject of work, it is very important that if you forget everything, at least you remember these few things. Number one, that work is not something you do when you feel like. It's not an option. Work is a divine mandate. It is a responsibility. Number two, that work is mirrored after God's own creative ability. That God does not just call us to work, but He models how we should work. He sets the standard of quality that should characterize the work that we do. Number three is that when we are called to do God's work, which is good work, we do it in a sinful and broken world. And because of that, our work will experience challenges. In our workplaces, we might be oppressed. There might be some injustices. Our work might not be as rewarding as we hope it to be, because we live in a fallen world, and for as long as we shall live, there will be sweating, there will be toiling, there will be going hungry, there will be some degree of misery, because we live in a sinful world. But number five, which is the good news, is that God has not left us to ourselves in this sinful and broken world. God has redeemed His creation, and in doing so, He has not only redeemed man, but He has also made a new meaning in the way the man should live his life, and that includes the area of work where God has blessed him. That now believers work with a renewed zeal and joy, because Jesus has redeemed them and given them an original perspective of what work was supposed to be. We work in the New Testament because we see Jesus not only encourage us to work, but He Himself continues working. He says, my food is to do the work that God has sent me to do. In John 17, we see Him saying, I thank you, O Father, for I have done and I have finished the work for which you sent me. Work done well results into God's glory. Work done well edifies the worker. You find fulfillment not in work for itself, but in the fact that God has designed the work to be a blessing to you. Work done well provides for you and for your loved ones. Work done well becomes a testimony and a witness in this sinful and broken world that indeed God is still at work in His creation, preserving, repairing, redeeming, sustaining it, and He will eventually present it to Himself on that last day. While God's original design for work was perverted by sin, God will one day restore work without the burdens that sin introduced. But until that day, when the new heavens and the new earth will be set in place, the Christian's attitude towards work should mirror that of Christ who has redeemed us. Like Jesus, we need to continue saying, our food is to do the will of Him that not only created us, but has redeemed us and adopted us as His children and preserved us for Himself and for His glory. We must continue to work and to live a life such as one that will bring glory to God. May the Lord bless you abundantly.